the elevator. So we're going to have a great night tonight. My name is Erin Hinkle. I am a parent, a 12-year-old little boy with autism, and a 6-year-old girl with childhood anxiety disorder. Amy and I, Clausen, we helped to start our parent support group, help partners for community connections, and I'm on the planning committee for Transition Booster Series. And out of Amy and all of our effort came these classes, which was special, and so pretty amazing that we were able to do this out of a support group. We have a couple great events coming up in May and June. The next Transition Booster meeting is May 11th, and it'll be on Medicaid and SSI. On May 2nd, a wonderful training will be taking place in Independence on charting the life course and advocacy with the North and East Ohio Community of Practice. In June, the Transition Booster Committee has added a housing expo because of the amount of requests on the topic. The expo will be held on June 25th in Pepper Park at the Friendship Circle of Cleveland from 2 to 4 p.m. We thank Friendship Circle for hosting this important event. All information about these wonderful events are on the back table. We have wonderful speakers tonight talking about post-secondary opportunities for our kids with disabilities. But before we get started, we'd like to address some comments on our evaluations. The Transition Booster Committee is not advocating to fight with your schools. It's important to recognize that there are many schools and professionals who are doing great jobs for kids with disabilities. The booster sessions are meant to share information and empower people to be better partners and work as a team with their schools. And we actually do have a handout tonight on keys to success, family, and school partnership. So please look for that back there. And we thank you for being here, and I'm going to pass it over to Wendy.
Hi, thank you again for being here. I'm Wendy Smith. I'm with LiveSpecial.com, and we help to make this happen along with the whole resource team of other wonderful people. But I wanted to point out the popcorn you guys all got today. That was a generous donation from the North Coast Corn Creation. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of it, but it's an amazing place. It was created to provide delicious popcorn, of course, but it also serves as an employment resource for people embracing autism. So everything that gets done, from the labeling to the making of the popcorn to the sealing of the popcorn to delivering it to some of the stores in Lake County to their storefront, is done with people with disabilities. So they have a website, they have a storefront. Their storefront is on Lakeshore Boulevard in Willoughby. It's kind of, I think, a little closer to Monster. So if you're in that area, they have weird hours, but they're open usually almost every afternoon. But you could call them and check. And they do have a website, and they ship. But it's a great place, and they have really fun flavors. When I was there yesterday, they have the traditional, of course, all the traditional cheeses and the cheddar, but they also have a new one out, Finding Dory. It was like a fruit flavor. They have Embracing Autism. I want to say they have salt and butter, white cheddar, jalapeno, pizza, dill pickle. I mean, you name it, they have all these crazy flavors. So if you can, check them out, spread the word. I also want to thank the Eisner Phone Group, because without them and without their support, they're in insurance company, they do all sorts of other stuff. They do a lot of support services for people with disabilities. They really helped to make this event happen. They helped us get the room, and they were big advocates for even allowing Live Special to exist. So Live Special is a free online website. If you guys don't know about it, check it out, because you can go onto the website and search for anything regarding special needs. Search by keyword and it'll tell you that. Thank you again for coming.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lori Kowalski. I work for the Upside of Downs. I also am a parent of 3 children, 2 of which are both transitioning currently. So I'm going to introduce our speakers. I'm going to introduce both of them right now, because we'll have an extremely short, brief break in between, but just to switch over the PowerPoint. So I'm going to introduce them both right now. Ron and Ginny Zybura are parents of 3 children and 2 grandchildren. Ron has been a special educator for over 40 years, working as a teacher, administrator, and group home director. He earned a PhD from Kent State University in special education with an emphasis on measurement. For the past past 20 years, Ron has worked in career and technical education with the goal of preparing students with disabilities for community employment and supporting career and technical educators to prepare diverse learners for employment. Dr. Yvonne Bonnie Nicolay is Director of the Career and Community Studies Program at Kent State University. CCS is a four-year, non-degree college experience to prepare students with intellectual and developmental disabilities, TBI, and autism for adult life through academic pursuits, peer socialization, and career discovery and preparation. Her research focuses on self-determination and in developing trainings for teachers, parents, and service providers to understand what it is and to better maximize opportunities that develop self-determination skills of persons with disabilities. In her spare time, Bonnie loves to spend time outdoors, having adventures with her husband, three sons, and four granddaughters. Shark fishing has become a recent passion for her and her family, and they enjoy going on fishing vacations together. So thank you for our speakers to come, and Ron,
it's a pleasure to be with you tonight, and every time I have a chance to meet parents and friends, I learn more than I impart. So I'm sure that'll be the case tonight. You have a resource handout with a pathway on it. We could look at that as the central idea of mostly everything we're going to talk about tonight. And for direct parent support, you also have a handout of parent mentors that are working in local schools. That I don't think it's three-hole punch. It was a single handout. It lists all the parent mentors. And my colleague at the State Support Team 3, we're neighbors just across the street on Oak Tree Boulevard, is Terry McEntee. And Terry's the parent and family support consultant who can provide resources and information. There were some booklets I passed out for the new IEPs that are coming out. They're not out yet, but hopefully we'll have information on that soon. So, you know, Terry would be a good contact person along with me for career tech. This would be the key organizing idea, that we're all on a pathway. We're on a pathway as parents to support our sons and daughters to pursue their passions for work and for community life. We're on a pathway as parents and friends to support students to pursue productive employment and productive community life. And I'm on that pathway as a grandparent, because I'm taking care of, I work half time and I'm taking care of Brecken and Brandon half-time also. So I just realized as I work with Brecken and Brandon how much work it is to be a parent. And the days that I have them from, say, 7:15 to, 4:30, 5 o'clock, I come home exhausted. So I have the deepest respect for what you're doing, because I'm getting a little refresher in doing that activity and loving every minute of it. So a couple of the things we'll talk about tonight is just rejuvenating yourself. Certainly as educators, to rejuvenate ourselves, to work with the stress that's present in educational settings. And, you know, as parents, to constantly rejuvenate ourselves to support our sons and daughters. And going to look at the idea of a pathway, that it's never straight. There's curves, and there's little risks. The curves are clear in how the rocks start out and then go up a bridge to hopefully would be community employment, would be community being successful in the community as a worker, or successful in another work setting. And Employment First maintains that community employment is a great goal. I've worked with students campers, as a camp counselor with severe cerebral palsy, blindness, and were inspirational people, and their main job was to teach me how to position them to get their braces on, how to position them to for dressing and toileting, and they were great at that. So whatever we do, whether it's working for money or working to manage our personal needs or to help somebody else with their personal needs, it's worthwhile work. And that pathway could represent a job that would be doing retail work, or it could represent self-help skills that empower you to connect with your caregivers and people that you're going to inspire just with managing the tasks of daily life. So a few of the resources we'll touch upon, and let me ask you so I can kind of adjust my remarks because my time is limited. How many of you have worked with Ohio Means Jobs? Great, so a number of people. And how many of you have worked with a program called VocFit, V-O-C-F-I-T, VocFit.com? Okay, that's a new program, and I believe Dr. Hale uses a similar model in matching student skills with job requirements. But the goal of VocFit or Ohio Means Jobs would be to make that transition from secondary school to post-secondary school so that there is no loss or no lag time, and the skills that you've developed in one setting can be transferred quickly to another setting without doing a lot of reassessment. And I think VocFit is a model that uses that pathway. The pathway could be looked at as the skills for a job, and that job could be doing some manufacturing, some light production, could be washing dishes, it could be stocking in retail. So the pathway, each stone would define a skill for that particular job, and then you would say, where is the worker on that pathway? And you would actually have a printout that says green is skills are in great shape. Yellow is skills that maybe need some intervention. And then orange is, well, these skills are particularly challenging. And red is these skills don't fit too well. And then a job developer could say to an OOD counselor, well, students mastered these skills in trial work settings, and the job coach can focus on these specific skills, or we could do an adjustment to the job responsibilities by engaging the employer and saying, what would be your preferences with those green areas, and if we worked on the yellows, be a productive employment setting? And there's the VocFit itself would be a presentation, but it uses that pathway again of the student being on a particular stone regarding to what you need to do for a particular job. And the reason I mentioned it is I'm hoping that people working in high schools can use the VocFit for part of their career assessment and then have the OOD counselor directly on that team to focus their efforts on picking up where the young man or woman is. Okay. Now, having been, just privileged to work in a number of IEP meetings with students that I would seek to place in employment, I know time is limited, and it's important to get everyone on the same page to have productive results. Also, there is a need for parent leadership to empower the team to work on a set of factors that will bring the quickest results and focus services. So I'm going to suggest that if you're using something with like VocFit, or you're using something from Ohio Means Jobs or Naviance for people, you're going to get a detailed list of job skills. But with the idea and using this matrix, which is the second part of your handout, There's really six factors that determine whether a student is going to be a good fit for a particular job. And the first factor is safety. When Paul O'Neill came to Alcoa Aluminum and the company was near bankruptcy and there was a lot of disagreement about what the union was doing and what management was doing and what their strategy was, focused on safety and made safety job one. And of course, as people who love their sons and daughters and grandchildren, safety is job one. So in a work situation, a unifying factor in looking at whether it's a community activity or a work situation is safety present? And then a high level of safety, you know, this could start in kindergarten. I'm doing it with my granddaughter crossing streets. A high level of safety would be listed as high level in the matrix. Safely works with materials and processes in school, career technical education labs, and or community work sites. And given that safety is the first thing you teach, what level of supervision do you need to maintain that safety? Whether it's in an amusement park or at Walmart or in a Giant Eagle parking lot, you know, doing carts, how much supervision do you need from a job coach or someone who's going to ensure that you know the safety components of whatever environment you're in? The third thing is, where can you be goal directed? And this is where your preferences, interests, needs, and strengths come into being. And I think the main point I could make this evening is that goal-directedness should be something that flows because you like to do it. And that's where career assessment comes in. In one of the handouts, I have just a few brief pages from a Cuyahoga Valley Career Center assessment. But a key point of assessment and all of the observations that take place over a period of time are, what environment can you be goal-directed in? Do you need to physically move? Do you need fine motor coordination? Do you need alertness? Do you need customer interaction? So what work settings would you be goal-directed in? And then if you're going to work for a long period of time, hopefully the rest of your life, what's your endurance for a particular goal? And that's where we're going to tie in a few things about building endurance and building focus. And then after you've established that, if you're a person, say, with autism, then you need to be belonging. You need to feel that sense of belonging. So that would be the fifth factor, and that would be teamwork or a social environment. And adjusting to that social environment so that you can be connected with people. You can come home at the end of the day feeling you have some friends or people you enjoy being with. And that really sustains you because it helps you push yourself, get self-discipline, because you're part of a team. And then the sixth factor, and probably the most important, is, can you assume responsibility to make choices when things don't go right? Can you figure out who to ask for help, or what strategy to use to resolve a problem? And again, if you have a very specific task analysis of all the job skills through Ohio Means Jobs or VocFit, then you'll have those detailed skills to determine where you would need to practice self-direction. Hopefully that would be a way that you could channel some of the efforts of the IEP team. And I found in my career that parents are the leaders in bringing a job from application to making it work, because, you know, you have the motivation to get to the job with your son or daughter, and then after a day of work to debrief and see how things went. And then, of course, transportation is part of that also. So I think those six factors are constantly being developed through your parenting. And of course, you're doing that in many different situations. And we're going to come back to VocFit and Ohio Means Jobs in a little bit. But I'd like to jump ahead to something called the Calm Classroom. And the Calm Classroom is a program that started in Chicago, and it basically says we all deal with a lot of stress. How many of you are dealing with stress as parents and caregivers? Educators? Yeah, not even a little bit. And the idea is that as we sit here after a busy day, you have all sorts of impulses that are filtering through your subconscious, through your amygdala, into your conscious. And those impulses could be, gee, did I get to the bank today? Did I make that deposit? Did I pay that bill? Did I meet that deadline for the field trip? Did I schedule that doctor's appointment? Will I have enough time to stop at the grocery store before I go home? And you find yourself in a situation where there's so many things that are filtering up in your conscience that it's hard to be present in the moment and saying, gee, life is good. I've had a good day, and I've got some plans to make for tomorrow. So the Calm Classroom, it started in Chicago. It's in over a third of the Chicago schools. It's in all of the Detroit public schools. It's growing in California. And they take brief exercises that involve stretching, breathing, and simple movements. Starts with preschool, goes all the way up through high school, and they're finding that achievement is increasing, students are more focused, discipline problems are going down, and for schools that are using a tier one intervention like PBIS, it's a strategy to help students center and calm down. And there's different ways of looking at it. It's strictly a physiological process that helps your brain manage the impulses that are below subconscious and be mindful in the present about what you can control. Because the past is the past is history, the future is a mystery. Right now, all we have is the here and now, which is why they call it a present. It's a gift. So that's what meditation does. Sometimes people will think that it's a spiritual practice. It can be if you take it to that level, but it's strictly a physiological practice, like learning to ride a bike comfortably and calmly. And like learning to ride a bike, you're first a little wobbly at it, and as you do it and practice it, it calms down. It helps you calm down. So we're going to come back to that in just a minute. I'm not going to take the time to show a lot of the Calm Classroom, but there's in your resource handouts. I have that focus on business and industry. So I looked at a couple business and industry examples of the role of meditation. And this one is from American Association of Individual Investors. And basically what it says is that people who are making decisions with the press of a button to move hundreds of thousands of dollars have a lot of stress. And many times act impulsively. And with disastrous results. So some of the big investment houses have actually set up meditation programs so people think about, well, gee, should I react to this, or is there a plan? And then for parents and teachers, their idea is when you listen to a CEO talk, listening with that inner voice, does the person have anxiety? Does the student feel upset? And that helps us as parents and teachers to focus on dealing with that feeling of upsetness and getting that person to center. And as was shared, for students who act impulsively, and really that could be all of teenhood, if you're working with teenagers, it's to get the, gee, I really should look carefully before I make that left turn. Now, it would be a good idea to back off on the pedal and keep the car on, at the speed limit. So all those things that are done impulsively, many times with accidents or especially in the workplace, the meditation helps us center. And the Calm Classroom and the website, there's a page in the handout with all the websites listed. And I will make this available on our drive. So if you want these links hot, I will share a link with you through email that you can share out. So the role of meditation is crucial in a teacher maintaining a calm in your classroom. For a student, when something is difficult, it's keeping that calmness. Just out of curiosity, how many of you meditate? Wow, that's great. So we have a number. We have a number of people. And So I find, you know, on the days that I know I'm going to have Brecken and Brandon for 8 hours or sometimes nine, if I meditate in the morning, I'm much calmer, and then I do my little 20 minutes of physical exercises, so I tone up because I know I'm going to be carrying one with one hand and, you know, chasing the other one around. So and the key to it is, and I didn't put this in, but I'd like to mention it. In all of our work with young people, habits are so critical. So if you do one good thing right, chances are, if a few things go wrong, you have that habit of expecting, I can do things. And you can take a setback with the idea that you've done something right. So as part of my educational career, I'd always try to look for, what does a student do well that I could say, well, gee, you know, you really had those tables all very clean today. You do a great job with that. Although the chairs were not put away properly or there was something to work on. If you can do one good thing right, then chances are that when the number of things aren't right, then you can say, well, at least something was good today. And I did a little research on that, and I find out that that's part of Navy SEAL training. That the first thing Navy SEALs have to do in training is make their bed. So if the day is a lousy day, when you come back at the end of the day, at least you come back to a made bed. But the habit is that you start off the day doing one good thing right, which could be meditating or going over what you're going to have to do for your job. And that leads to another thing, and another thing, and another thing. So you're on a productive cycle, and you get things. You feel like you have some control. So, for those of you who do meditate, this will be easy. And for those who would like to try a 3-minute exercise from the Calm Classroom, we can do that. If you don't want to meditate, maybe just look at a handout or just be comfortable. This is going to be 3 minutes in the high school setting, and there is a guided exercise in your handout about meditation. And also, there's some wonderful meditations that are referenced in the PowerPoint, which you'll have access to, that are guided meditations for people just learning to meditate. So we are going to practice a Calm Classroom technique today called body scan. You'll be holding your body still as you pay attention to how different parts of your body feel. For example, bring your attention to your feet and see if you can feel them without moving them. You'll be relaxing and noticing how each part of your body feels as I guide your attention to it. We are going to practice body scan. Sit up comfortably in your chair. and close your eyes. Feel your feet flat on the floor. Feel the air moving in and out of your nose. If you notice any thoughts passing through your mind, let them float away. Without moving them, feel and relax your feet. Bring your attention to your legs. Relax your legs. Move your attention to your stomach. Relax your stomach. Notice your lower back. Relax your lower back. Bring your attention to your shoulders. Relax your shoulders. Feel your arms, hands, and fingers relaxing. Remember to breathe deeply. Feel your jaws, eyes, and forehead relaxing. Notice your whole body. Let your whole body relax. Now slowly wiggle your toes. Slowly wiggle your fingers. Keep your eyes closed gently. Sit up straight and comfortably in your chair. Now take a deep breath in. Hold. And exhale slowly. Notice how you feel. Slowly open your eyes. Okay, thank you for doing that exercise. And I signed up for a course to teach this to young people, and there's an index in your handout about the 13 cycles of different exercises to do that are basically stretching, yoga, and breathing, all 3-minute exercises that are tailored from kindergarten all the way through high school, and hopefully bringing more peace in stress-filled schools, and I think for us caregivers, really necessary to just to be centered and managing the 50 things we have to do. And I think, you know, I'm learning how to do this, and the trick is to teach it to kindergartners. I haven't done that with my 3-year-old granddaughter, but I'd like to introduce that to her just in the form of breathing. And I'm thinking the first time to do that is when I'm with her and learning swimming. And that would be, you know, one way to master breathing as you bob. And I could even practice it on land with her to get her ready to, you know, to hold her breath and to breathe and to swim. So the reference explains there's different types of meditation, and and one that was particularly interesting was the one that athletes do would be to visualize yourself, tonight's the big game with the Cavs and Indiana. to visualize yourself sinking those three point shots, defending someone, you know, very much used in sports. And then I think as the discipline that you mentioned, there's a meditation that's mentioned in American Association of Individual Investors. It's called the compassion meditation. So if you're in conflict with someone, to envision that person and then to picture forgiving that person, being peaceful with that person, you know, being able to communicate with that person. And I think that's particularly important in school settings where, you know, you have bullying, you have, you know, competition for popularity and things like that. Okay. All right, let's move to if you have a good centered position to pursue goals, and you want to know, you know, what are the best goals to pursue? And again, from business, Peter Drucker, who is a wonderful kind of leader in business, said, "Don't solve problems, pursue opportunities." So that's the essence and the goal of selecting your career, your job. And if you have a job that's congruent with your preferences, interests, needs, and skills, then you'll pursue opportunities and hopefully match that style of contentment and that style of satisfaction with a job situation. So a very common assessment instrument is the career profile or the interest inventory. Thanks, Lenny. And that's used at the Career One Stops. It's used in Ohio Means Jobs. It's present. It's called the Career Profile. It's used nationally on onet.com as the interest profiler. And at the back page of right after the meditation sections, after the handout suggested order for implementation, you have an explanation of the six personality types. And the idea is that each of us needs some of these personality types. There's another handout that has a graphic of that too, but we won't need that now. So if you look at this spreadsheet, these items are the items that your son or daughter, probably in high school, would actually take to see what type of personality to match with the work environment. Everybody find that? Yes. Okay. And the first type is artistic, and you can see from the items, it's play a musical instrument, compose, draw pictures. The next type is conventional, and that would be detail-oriented. And that would be assembling parts, operating a calculator, keeping shipping and receiving records. And the next component would be entrepreneurial, and that would be maybe running for class office, being a manager, starting your own business, marketing a new line of clothing. The next category would be investigative, and that could be developing a new medicine, conducting chemical experiments, etc. And then very common among a lot of students I worked with is realistic, the R. And you can see teaching sports, repairing and installing locks, being a carpenter, being an electrician, being a plumber, being a warehouse operator. And the last category, which hopefully our teachers are strong in, is social. And that's volunteer work, taking care of young people at a daycare, teaching a high school class. So again, to go back to our pathway metaphor, if we look at that pathway and you look at artistic, you see the behaviors that are on the test. And they're to write books, play an instrument, compose, and those behaviors are what's standardized to say, yep, if you follow that pathway and you rate that high with all fours, then you're on the pathway to do something artistic. But of course, as parents and leaders, you're thinking, well, what other behaviors would match artistic that you could reinforce in your son or daughter? And if you think of behaviors that are like the A's we have on the spreadsheet, you can reinforce that emerging interest. And the fun of it, which is the sine qua non, the most important thing, the thing you really get your bang for a buck, if you can take a person where they are artistically, say they're drawing, and they need a little work and perspective, and if you're an art teacher and you can teach them how to set perspective so they can create it in their drawings, then you're pushing that person just where they need to be. And I think we all want to do that with our friends, with our family members, with the people we love. You know, you take them, you support them to a point where they come up with something challenging, and then you say, you can do this. You know, this is important. You can do it, and I support you to do this. So whether it's therapy or cleaning your room, whatever behavior is a little challenging, to push that person to accomplish that behavior and to move into a zone where something new is acquired. And that could be leading to competitive employment, and hopefully it's competitive employment that stresses your interest, your personality skill level that's high. Now, that doesn't mean someone who's who's realistic and is an auto mechanic can't be investigative, because they may need to figure out, gee, where's that knock in the car coming from? What other cars do I know that had this similar knock? So we all use all six of these, but we, according to the theory, and I think it makes some sense, we have a predominant part where someone who's social needs to be social. They need to talk with people. They need to be listening to people. They need to be connected with people. And they may be realistic in that they're going around their classroom and they're setting up workstations and they're setting up tables, but they're really interested in those boys and girls. They're interested if they feel comfortable, if they feel like they belong. They're interested to see if they're learning new things. And that social part is strong, although they're doing the investigative part. You know, somebody needs to remember to do a field trip form. They're figuring out, gee, I know if I send home a note and I put it in this compartment of the bag, it's going to get home. So we use all of them, but we want to know which one is the strongest. So let's start out with us. If you could please look at that and decide which, and see if it's valid with what you like and what you really like to do. See which one of these would fit you. The artistic, the conventional, the entrepreneurial, the investigative, the realistic, or the social. I had the good fortune to overhear a conversation, and it was two individuals talking about how they would work together, say, for a joint venture. And one person said, well, I have these characteristics, and that's who I am. And the other person said, well, I have these characteristics, and that's who I am. And I thought, wow, that's really how life is. That if you're a very, say, creative person, and you're maybe not too detail-oriented, and details may be a weakness. And if you're really strongly social, you may not be that investigative, willing to sit down and be in doubt about a process and be constantly trying different things. So the opposite of our strengths is our weaknesses. And I thought, well, is this true? And when I was preparing this talk, so I found Ray Dalio, and he is just after the meditation. And Ray Dalio was a very unsuccessful high school student. His mother would say, go to your room and study. And Ray wouldn't do it. And did terrible in high school. And then all of a sudden, Ray got to college and found out he could choose his classes and he could take things he was interested in, and got interested in business. And it turned out Ray Dalio was one of the most successful businessmen in the world, runs Bridgewater Capital, which is one of the most successful investment firms in the world, and he's a billionaire. And he came up with these 10 characteristics for using your strengths, your personality type, and it may not be captured here because this isn't the end all and be all, but it's knowing that strengths. Again, it's pursuing opportunity, doing things that you like to do, and he said, be truthful about it. And you're gonna fail, but move forward. Learn from your disagreements. You know, how important for an IEP team. If you're driving an IEP team and you want to know the six factors where your son or daughter can be successful, and you want that whole team pulling together to find that perfect work environment, you're going to have disagreements. But you do have a unifying common interest. And then raise the center of Ray's success, and the success had to come from all the information in the world is already in markets. It's set in the price of things. You have to be able to see what other people don't see. And it's the same for us. You have to have a vision for your son or daughter that is something that maybe others don't see. Maybe your son or daughter doesn't see it. But because you've paid attention to the characteristics, the person's expressions, you've been watching that boy or girl play since they were a baby, you have an idea where that could go. And you can get them at that sweet spot where they just need a little extra encouragement to master the next skill. And then he talks about the five things that you need to do to accomplish your passion. He said, what is your goal or passion? And then what challenges or problems? You know, what is the obstacle to getting that job? Be honest, diagnose the problem, and then what do you do to get around it? Assistive technology, a mentor, a script, all the things we do to get the workplace comfortable for a student. And then you take that habit. For Navy SEALs, it was making your bed and then starting going through the process. In work, what do you do right that the boss is going to like, that's going to meet the company mission, and then how do you build on that and repeating that cycle. But in that cycle is going to be some failure, is going to be some frustration. That's why the meditation comes into play, and that's why using your strengths, because that's where your passion will be, really pays off. I'm out of time. Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. So these guys contacted me and said, we'd really like you to come up and we want to talk about your program at Kent State. We want to talk about what's going on at other colleges, post-secondary programs in the state. We want you to talk about helping us understand what we need to know to better transition our students into adult life. And then we want you to talk about the differences between IDEA and ADA. And oh, by the way, you only have an hour to do it. Impossible. In fact, I was jokingly thinking on my way up today that I thought, man, I wish we had popcorn and pajamas and we could just settle in for the night, because that's how much time it takes. I actually do a four-hour workshop. It'll be the first Saturday in October from 8:30 to 12:30. A little commercial. If you really want to know all the details of the CCS program, how we support the students, what courses look like, you need to come to that one because I can't get into that tonight. And we really spend a lot of time. So just for me to get a little bit of a feel, parents, I recognize a few. Parents, okay, majority. Service providers, okay. Teachers, yay teacher. I give a disclaimer right up front. I speak very directly. I know no other way how to do it. I am not going to talk, and a lot of things I'm going to talk about, I am not pointing fingers. I am just saying, here's the need. Here's what we're seeing. I have the great opportunity of having students ages 18 to 26. I'm seeing the end product after they've gone through with parents and teachers, and I can speak very much on what's still missing. So I don't know how to be, I'm not wishing to offend, I'm not pointing fingers, it's just how can we do better to work ourselves out of a job with our students. Couple of resources. This is one. Anytime that we were working with a student in the program and I see, oh man, I wish they could have started earlier on developing this skill so that when by the time they come to me or and the faculty that work with me, by the time if they could have already had this, how much further could we have taken them? So there's no rhyme or reason to this. I just keep throwing them up there. Tonight, I hope to give you some resources that you will have hundreds of IEP goals and things to be considering to help your student get ready for adult life. I will talk a lot about a college program because that's what I do. But take college out of it, and every time I say college, just you insert adult life, because that's what we're all doing is getting ready for adult life. There's another resource that's not on here, but it's a resource of the colleges in Ohio that have post-secondary programs, and it's kind of a profile of each college. So that's another resource if you would please send out. This is another resource for you. As parents, as teachers, as service providers, if you want to know how to start developing some of these skills, if you want to know how to start getting your student, and that's what I'm really talking about here. It's not about you telling your student what they can or cannot do or what they are good at or what they need to consider for their areas of difficulty. It's how much can we pass on to them? It's them. It's their life. How much can we pass on to them? So here's kind of a neat thing. And again, this is always morphing because as we become enlightened, oh, here's another area. We'll throw it on here. So these are constantly morphing. Maybe you're going to have some you can share with me that I can add on there also. But for instance, helping a student understand for themselves, and this is what I see in our program. Students come to me and they'll say, well, I'm really good at this. And well, I'm like, how do you know that? Because everybody tells me that. We stop right there and say, the next 4 years is to help you learn to be able to say, I know what I'm good at. I know what I prefer. I know what I'm interested in. And I also understand my disability. Parents, teachers, we need to start using that D word, because I'll tell you why. When your student leaves high school and moves into the adult world, and they start working with adult service providers or employers, if you can't speak to those areas that are difficult for you, and if you can't say, yes, I do have a disability, but here's how I can have the accommodations and I'll still be one of your best employees. We have to use that D word. I've had students in the program that have come and their parents said, I've never told them they have a disability. Please don't tell them. And I said, then don't bring them here. Because that's the way that we empower. And we know the areas, when we know what we are good at, our strengths. But if we don't understand those areas that are difficult for us, we can never make the most out of our strengths. We must know our whole package. If you want, so emerging starts at home. Parents, are you listening and providing opportunities for your student to explore and become aware of their spins? It's where it starts. And then we know that it's making progress is because the student is starting to see, we're starting to see things in the schools, and we're starting to see them be having opportunities to again explore for themselves, this is what I know. And then you know when you've achieved it. There's all kinds of ideas there if you're wanting to develop problem-solving skills, goal-setting skills, those kinds of things, self-determination, all kinds of ideas. Turn these into goal statements. Getting ready for college. Should have slashed that word and said adult life, but this is what we're going to talk about. When you're talking with your student, start talking to them. Why do you want to go to college? What are some reasons? Reasons to go to college. One reason may be, you know, to get ready for a career. Have a discussion with them. What's the difference between job and career? Can they speak to why what one is and what the other is? A lot of people go to college because they're not sure what to do after high school. Absolutely. Maybe taking some classes will help you figure that out. There's a reason why the majority of students going to college change their major several times. It's because you only know what you know. And it isn't until you have greater opportunities to know more, to be able to start making decisions about, I never knew that. I want to explore that. And boy, that's what we know about our students with disabilities is they often are not provided the same kind of opportunities. And when I talk about self-determination in a little bit, we're going to hit that. Why, if they're not provided as many opportunities as possible, why we are crippling our students. Another reason, everybody else is, of course, another reason to go to college, to meet new people. It's going to look good on my resume. Went to college. Proves my chances of getting a job and to be able to make more money. And you know, these are all reasons for people to go to college. All reasons, and no one better than the other, because it's about the opportunity to have a chance to really grow, mature, and that's what college is for all students. 4 years to figure out who you are, what do you believe in, and it's much more than just the content of courses. It's the people that you meet. You know, the friends you meet in college most likely will be the friends that you have throughout life, not so much from high school. The networking that you make, the connections that you make, as well as things that you're learning and work experiences that you're getting. Seeing some of our students. So here's things, conversations. How's college different from high school? It takes our students quite some time, and about 2 or 3 weeks after they've started their freshman year, I'll go into class and I said, okay, you've been here long enough. What's different? When will the bells start to ring? The bells are done. There are no more bells unless you learn to think for yourself and set them for yourself. No more bells. In high school, students considered a child. And if you want to know, parents, the hardest thing for you to get used to is that starting at the age of 18 and definitely when they're leaving high school, you're cute little boy or girl is no longer a child, they're an adult, and the society looks at them as adults. And it's time for you to start treating them as adult. And boy, is that hard. Whether your student has a disability or not, it's hard. Going to college. When students come to my program, they're college students, and even if you have guardianship, I cannot legally talk to you unless your student signs a FERPA form that says I may. And I have students that have said you can talk to my mom but not my dad. And I have to do that. Dad calls me and threatens to sue me. I'm like, I know you're paying the bill, but it's not. He didn't sign that I could. That's your issue, not mine. I have to go by what the rule in the law says, Family Education Rights to Privacy Act, FERPA. That's really hard for parents to get used to. You're not in the driver's seat anymore. Get in the back. And that's where your support now is coming from the back seat. You're not driving. And I know when we've been teaching our children, our students, how to drive, it is the most nerve-wracking thing to not feel like you're in control. And parents, I don't know how to tell you any more than you're going to want to throw up on this ride. Because you already are. It's a nerve-wracking ride, and I can't prepare you anymore unless you've started to prepare yourself and your student earlier in life. Because the more that you do that, the more confidence your student has and the more confidence you will have in your student. And it won't be such a bumpy ride, but you will throw up for a while. High school, it's mandatory, you have to go, but college is voluntary. It's a privilege. You have to earn the right to stay there. It's expensive. College is. High school's usually free. High school, other people make your schedule, and in college, you have to learn how to make your own schedule, / adult life. It's time for you, if you want to have the quality of life, young adult, if you want to have the quality of life that you can feel like you're doing things that are meaningful to you, which isn't that what we all want for ourselves, they have every right also. You have to learn how to handle all of this. High school, other people tell you when to go to classes. College, you have to manage your own time. The bells, oh, those bells. No more bells. You have to start to think for yourself. High school. You can count on parents and teachers to remind you when homework. And boy, is this one a struggle. Because we will not. We teach them what a syllabus is. We teach them how to use their planners, how to use their tools. We work with them. Of course, it doesn't happen overnight, but that is our motto, is to work ourselves out of a job. And I tell parents when they come and they're interested in the CCS program, and I said, this is a program that is preparing your student for the day you die. Because as parents, aren't we concerned that what's going to happen to my student if something happens to me? It's scary. I have 3 sons, 4 granddaughters. It's scary. But that's how the approach we take. How much can we move them forward? How much can we put into their laps, into their ownership, that will help them be able to have the coping skills in place for the day they may have to do this more on their own without you? Each day you go from one class to the next in high school, in college. You know what a college schedule is like. You might even have a day you don't have any classes. They're bounced all over the place. Way more time spent on doing assignments. And it's more than just the assignments. It's the outside of classwork that is also a big part of it. Some classes may be large, though the majority of the classes our students have are small, but they do. There are some that get into larger classes. Reading, assignments, discussing, taught in class, in college classes, a lot is done on what you have to do. We know how we have those 5 weeks. Here's where I want to talk about what happens during those 5 weeks or when you have all summer off, if you are in a college program. Our skills regress so quickly. We've worked hard all year to build skills, and we see some amazing, amazing skill development, and then summer hits and we go all summer, and that's where it comes back to parents keeping your student busy during the summer so they continue to practice those skills. In high school, you're usually told when your behaviors are out of line and there's a discipline, and in college, you're expected to have the behaviors in place. If you don't, we're talking about consequences, not somebody that's going to come in along and discipline you. The consequences, because that is adult life. Adult life is, if we know that we've done something we shouldn't and we get caught, there's going to be consequences, and we know that. You know, it's so true. So many students, especially when they're coming to college. Yes. And I'm not talking about students just with disabilities. All college. Yes, I can't wait to get out of house. I am gonna party like there's no tomorrow because there's no more rules. I only want to get to where I don't have to be at home and there's no more rules. And then it is such a terrible, terrible disappointment to have to go through the learning curve to realize as adults we have way more rules. Sometimes we would love to go back to where we don't have so many rules and consequences. And boy, our students just really struggle sometimes with that. Teachers, this is actually, I was thinking we would have more students here, so I kind of went this route. But these are conversations. You have the PowerPoints. Have these conversations with your student. You're wanting to go on to college. Here's how it's different. Here's how the school teachers are different. How the college professors, and because I can't wait to get on to the next thing, I'm not going to read all of these like I was. You have them in your handouts. But here's the differences. The difference between tests and exams. How grading occurs. Grades in high school, grades in college. In high school, some students who have difficulties with learning have an IEP. In college, parents, there are no IEPs. And I think that is another thing that is very, very difficult. Because in high school, you have a law that gives you your IEP, which is IDEA, Individuals Disability Education Act. And it is the Cadillac. You get so many accommodations. Sometimes you might have to advocate for them. But there is so much built into IDEA. But then when you leave high school, I always say it's ideas like you have a life jacket and you're floating your student along with all the accommodations and special considerations. And then when you graduate, it's give me my life jacket back, because now you have to go into the adult life using American Disability Act and Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act. And those accommodations will not even be close to what many students have through high school. When our students are in college, when they come to our college program, they all register with our student accessibility services. And I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. Student accessibility services will look at your documentations, your IEP, anything that you bring. They'll look at that and they will determine what your accommodations will be under ADA and Rehab 504. I had a student and his mother that went to SAS with all of their documentation and handed and said, these are the accommodations. And I warned them, but these are the accommodations, 24 different accommodations that particular student had. Our SAS person went down through, said, nope, nope, yep, yep, nope, had 5 or 6. That is the difference. And so because our students, our young adults have to get, that's what they're going to have the rest of their life. Those are the accommodations that we follow because we want them to practice them and get so good at that because we need them to make the most and get their biggest bang for their buck out of those accommodations. Okay? Those are the accommodations. And that's, even if you don't go to college, that's the way it is in the adult world. High school with IDEA is about success. That's why so many extra accommodations and considerations. It's about being successful. Once you leave and you go into the adult world, it is only about access, not success. Hence the differences in the way the laws address. Everybody understand the difference? Success, access. Okay. In high school, all students are covered. In college, students have to qualify using prior documentation. They have to have the IEP ahead of time, and they are just using it as documentation. But it's not going to be, it has to be something that's already in place, and they just use it. High school parents, you're highly involved. College, we already kind of talked about it, didn't we? In college, you take the back seat. Your involvement is optional. However, in the CCS program, we understand the importance of having you as part of the team and helping the student prepare for adult life because you're the one that's going to be there. You're also the one paying the bill. It's no longer free. And we know the importance of that, but everything gets run through your student. We work with your student, and if it gets to the point that we say, you know what, this is something that you're really struggling with, and we really need to bring mom and dad in on this, it's always through them first. And they will be part of the meetings. We really work hard to develop a good, strong relationship, trusting relationship with them, and they understand quickly. They'll even say, no, don't tell mom, don't tell dad. And if it's something that we say, you know what, it is your call, but let's discuss what happens if you don't. So it's on them. It's on them understanding when is it time you need to reach out and ask for help if it's something bigger than what we're managing. Personal service aids provided, again, through the IEP and IDEA, not in college, not in adult life, unless you pay for them yourself. But they're no longer a guarantee. And in college, no personal services are provided. We have students that need a personal aid, but it's the student or the parent family that have to provide if they need it for any kind of physical reasons. So, success versus access, colleges are generally not going to provide the following. Colleges slash adult life. Those are the things, and you can read them in your PowerPoint because an hour is not enough. So those are some of the main things that the difference is there. Oh, going to college is all about food too, right? Big part of it. We work with our students to develop good habits, and so we explain to them that most college students gain the freshman 15. Actually, I think that's inflated too. I think it's now up to the freshman 30. So we really, everything that we do is working to help them develop good habits, including exercise and nutrition. So how to make the transition to college? If a student can come and really understand for themselves, these are the things I know about myself that I do well. So often we have students one of two ways. Seldom do we see students that have a true sense of them, of a realistic sense of self. Often it's their estimation of their abilities is overinflated. And perhaps it's because the way that we have tried to encourage them. I want to talk about the way that we provide that encouragement. We have what we call external motivation and internal motivation. External motivation is so often what our students, what we see in our students, that they've had all their life people around them that have said, nice job, good, you did that great, whether they did or not. You did a good job, way to go, keep going, do that. We recognize in our students when we see them coming to us that they are so tuned in to needing people to tell them when they're doing a good job that they have no clue how to tell that for themselves. We had a student that was taking a bowling class for a PE class, and we had a mentor that went with him to class and helps him get acclimated to the class. He would roll the ball down, and he could not pick the next ball up and do another until that mentor told him whether it was good or not. And again, we work ourselves out of a job. We don't do that. And so he stood there and stood there and stood there. He was frozen in time because I can't do anything unless people are telling me if I'm doing it good or not. That's external motivation. Now, all of us like a little pat on the back once in a while. That's fine. And I'm talking, that part's okay. But when it is the only thing that we're doing, then how do they ever take that internally? And they're learning to do things for themselves because it feels good inside of me. I know I'm doing a good job. So we don't give praise, at least not right off the bat. Student comes in and they'll talk to us about, you know, this is something that they just did, wanting us to say, yes, way to go, good job. Instead, we say, how do you think you did? What does that feel inside? What are you feeling inside? Because what we're raising is self-awareness, which is one of the 9 skills of self-determination. Raising that self-awareness, tell me what you feel inside. Does it feel good to you? If it does, then you know you're on the right track. You're doing something right. In time, they get to where they'll come in and tell me, this is what I did, and this is the result that I got, and I feel proud of myself. That's self-efficacy, and that's truth. That is a true sense of self. But boy, is that hard. And so I challenge you, reconsider how you're giving praise. Think about, what is the end result? Do they really know for themselves? Or are they going to need you the rest of their lives to tell them when they're doing it right or when they're not? Again, I don't know how to be any more direct. I just throw it out there. So often our students, it is a bit of a process to teach them the correct way and timing of asking for help. When they first start as a freshman, we know they're coming in and it's going to take them a while. We have so much to learn, but we have such awesome things in place to help. But it takes a process for them to start to think for themselves, to start to problem solve, come up with ideas on how to fix your problem or whatever it is that you're wanting to change, to take the initiative to start trying something. And we have that process. And about the 4th, 5th week into the first semester of a freshman year, we implement the rule, you try 3 things before you just automatically ask for help. Now, it's a process. It takes time. But again, we're working ourselves out of a job. So often the first thing student says, I don't know what's the answer. Will you do this for me? And we always say, what did you try before you came to me? 3 things before me. What that is helping them to do is to start to think for themselves. It's starting to build up in their bank, their mental bank of, these are the things that I've done before and they worked for me, and we're starting to create that bank that we can reach in and pull out strategies. And in the next 4 years, we start building that bank of strategies up so that they can become better choice makers and decision makers and goal setters and goal attainers. There's a reason why the resource word is highlighted, because that is so important to know what a resource is, how to find those resources, how to use those resources, how to speak to those resources. And that is a word that those students probably hear every class, every day, throughout the day, in every situation, is this is what you want to do, how do you do that? What are your resources? Getting them good to use it. And so here's all these ideas. If we could start these clear back, not even during the transition years, we need to start clear back into early elementary, if not before, to start thinking, what am I doing now that helps my student to better transition down the road, disability or no? SAS, Student Accessibility Services. They're about finding out if the student is qualified. 2 steps when you go to college, you have to make an appointment and take your documentation to the Student Accessibility Services office. They will examine it and make the determination of what accommodations. Help your student understand the difference between accommodations and modifications, because as an adult, they're going to have to ask for accommodations and modifications. and they need to know what it is, when do you ask for it, what resources to tap into to help them get those accommodations and modifications. It should not be a student sitting in their IEP meetings and not be able to speak to this. So parents, I challenge you to start bringing your student into, and teachers, bring that student into their IEP in a stronger and stronger way. I hate person-centered planning meetings. I've been in a lot of them. But that's a big thing here, person-centered planning, all over the place. The importance of person-centered planning. I see the value of it, but I hate how they're done because, again, so often the ones that I was involved in, it was the student sitting there for a long, long, terrible time with no understanding, very little understanding of what to say or speak for. And, man, this is the whole idea is what do you want to do in your life and how do we help you plan for it? And they have very little input. We have to do person-centered planning. It's part of what we said to the at the federal level that allows our non-degree program, our students, to still apply for financial aid. We had to say that we were going to do person-centered planning meetings. And I'm like, we're done doing them the old way. What we do now is all year long, while the student's taking classes, involved in social activities, whatever the student is doing, we're capturing, they are capturing those moments. And right now, they are creating their person-centered planning PowerPoints. And on May 6th, a Saturday, they will present their PowerPoint to their parent, and they will speak for 90 minutes in front of their families and their supports. This is who I am. This is what I'm learning. This is my short-term goals, my long-term goals for academic, for independent living, for community inclusion, and employment. Powerful. Powerful, powerful. But you have to capture it in the moment. You can't wait to the end of the year and say, okay, tell me what you did. Because our students, especially the students that we work with, the intellectual and developmental disability students that could not get into college through traditional doors, cannot pass ACT entrance exams, do not have diplomas. They can still come to college through our doors. We can't expect them to think about it all year long and that now write it down. It's capturing it in the moment. Boy, teachers, parents, if you can help your student throughout their school year capture things in the moment so that when the time comes, they can make their own personal centered planning PowerPoint and present it to you, you're onto something. I would guess SSTs in the adult service providers, I would think that would be pretty powerful if you had someone come to you to say, this is me. These are my short-term and my long-term goals, and this is what I've prepared for. And you could say, okay, I know what you want, and we can work with you and move you forward. This is our CCS website. And like I said, I am not going to get into a lot of details, and there is so much that we have built into the program that provides the support and the modifications that we've created our curriculum, the four-year curriculum. These are the skills that we feel if a student, a young adult, has a good sense of all of these different things, that they're going to be very prepared for adult life. They'll have greater successes. And our curriculum takes those standards and we address those and we approach all of these different skills in many, many classes in many, many different ways over and over again. It's all right. You get in there and look. If you're wondering what kind of things do we need to put in IEP goals, there's 203 ideas just in that document, plus what we've already given you, and plus other resources that are on that our website. There will be hundreds of ideas, and those are all things that we will be working on in the CCS program. But boy, if they came with that already, we could add more, take them even further. Self-determination, this is a training. We've created this training. This is my research focus. You look at the literature out there and it tells us that our students with disabilities are not as determined as their peers without disabilities. And there's a lot of reasons it gives. It'll say, too hard to include self-determination, development of self-determination activities in our classrooms. Maybe we don't want our students to, this is actually out there, maybe we don't want our students to be self-determined because it'll be harder to keep control of them. That literature is out there. That tells me there's a huge misinterpretation or misunderstanding of what self-determination is, which leads to the next thing is, literature out there says teachers, and I'm going to put parents in that same category. We know it's important, but we really don't know what it is, because self-determination is this concept that has so much in it that we really kind of like, we know it when we see it, but I really can't tell you what it is. We've pulled it apart and really focused on exactly what is going on in self-determination and created a training that really helps people, persons working with our students and our students, because there's the other thing. The literature out there says all these things that we have to do to promote self-determination in our students, but there's nothing out there that says, how do we take it and put it right into the student's hands? How do we help the student understand what it is, why it's important, and if they want to do anything in life, they have to know how to use these 9 skills to the best, because these are the skills you, myself, every person that's breathing, use from the minute we open our eyes till we close them at night. We are using those skills. So much we do is on autopilot. We don't stop to think what we just did, but if we did and pulled it apart, we did use the skills of self-determination. Self-determination, again, this is a training, but you're going to get a real fast around the world in 80 days. Self-determination are these 9 skills that we use in different quantities and different combinations, but we use them all together. I call it my cake. My cake has 9 ingredients. I just had a college professor want me to come in to one of his classes, but he only wanted me to talk about self-efficacy, and I said, I will not. Because you can't understand self-efficacy if you don't understand the other 8 ingredients. Your cake will not be good with only 1 ingredient. He went away a little bit mad at me because he's like, well, no, I don't buy it. And I'm like, then don't ask me, because it's all 9 together. Problem solving. The training that we do, it's we really get in there and dig that problem solving actually has 5 steps within problem solving. And the training is to help us in the environment understand what's going on so that, and my mentors that work in my program, my staff, they get so good at this that they can watch a student and say, I know what they're in. They're problem solving and they're stuck on step number 3. How can I come alongside and nudge or provide another opportunity to help that student continue to move forward? It is possible. And when you get this and begin to look at everything that you do with the student through the lens of self-determination, it actually makes your classroom times easier. Sounds maybe counterintuitive. You don't have to do anything special. You just have to be watching for what's happening. Problem solving, in its short version, is being able to identify what it is that you want to change. Often we look at problem solving as a negative word. It must be something bad. We need a bad habit. No, problem solving is what it is that you want to do. What is it you want to change? Once you've defined and identified what that is, you roll into choice making. Choice making is not saying, do you want the Pepsi or do you want the Coke? So often that's what I see that people understand that choice making is letting them act as self-determined persons because I'm letting them choose apple or orange. That is not self-determination, that is manipulation, because you've made the choices. You have not helped them go through the process of learning what's going on underneath to make those changes. So choice making, all it is coming up with ideas. Put as many ideas in your bucket as you can. It is not a time that we say, no, that won't work, or that's not a good idea. It's just brainstorming if you must with others, but you're only putting ideas. And boy, parents and teachers, if you can help your student begin to do that without you providing any wise pros and cons, because when you start doing pros and cons, you've moved into decision making. Once you have your choices, your ideas in your bucket, and you must have at least two. If you only have one, not a choice, must have at least two. The more, the better. And then you pull out one idea, and now you weigh the pros and cons. Lay it down. Pull out the next one, weigh the pros and cons. When you're done, you look at all of your decisions, all the pros and cons, and you pick one. Now we're in decision making, finishing it up. You pick one. This is what I want to start. And boy, I don't care if, unless it's a major safety issue, even if you know that there was a better option, you don't say it. Because your student must be able to act that decision out and see the benefits or missed the mark for themselves. I don't know about you, and what we're talking here is dignity of risk. I don't know about you, but the best lessons that I ever learned was when I did something and I did it wrong. And I had to learn from it, even if it hurt. Even if emotionally it hurt and I cried. I deserved that opportunity to learn for myself, and your student deserves the same. Because it's by trying things out and learning from it is when we make that lasting change. Once you've picked that and you said, this is the one that I want to do, you turn that into a goal statement. I will, whatever it was that decision was, I will do this. During goal setting, you also break it down into your steps. Set up your plan. And then you begin to self-regulate. As you're working towards reaching your goal, you're regulating or monitoring your behavior. Are you on track? Are you going to reach? These are all behaviors we're talking about. The last behavior is self-advocacy. Are you able to use your resources to accomplish what you want to do? Do you know what your resources are? Are you able to speak why you want this and in the time that you need it? Those are the seven behaviors, and now the last two are attitudes. And boy, we know with our students that those abstract concepts are so hard, which is why self-determination can be hard at first. The last two are attitudes. Self-efficacy is as your student begins to do things for themselves and they're gaining confidence and realizing that they can make these achievements, maybe small at first, but they're beginning to build. That's when self-efficacy, or the belief in yourself, the belief that you can take on challenges a little bit harder than where you currently are. Keep those expectations high, and boy, there's a killer. We were asked in our program, faculty and I, and they, from parents, that said, you have high expectations. We do. When do you realize your student can't do it and you lower them? And I say, we never do. All we do is continue to support and encourage and keep your eye on the ball and keep your expectations high and do everything you can. Now, will the student maybe reach everything? Perhaps not, but they're going to go a heck of a lot further by having it. You get what you expect. If you lower your expectations, they'll lower their performance. And we see our students doing some amazing things, and our first cohort that graduated are working. You know, 14%, it fluctuates a little bit, but the national average for our students with intellectual and developmental disabilities, 1 year after they graduate from high school, only 14% are working. National averages, pretty dismal. Our first cohort that graduated in May of 2015, we had 18 of the 20 that started our pilot program graduated. That's pretty amazing. One dropped out, the other one had health issues, and he will finish up this fall, so we will have 19 have graduated. Of those group that had graduated, 84% of them are working in part to full-time employment and competitive wages. Many of them in the field that they've chosen. We had two wanted to work as a teacher's aide, and we know in Ohio you have to have a paraprofessional certificate, but we found a way to get around that by getting them connected to temp services that don't require that, and then they get to go into schools and work, and they've done such an amazing job that one of them's working full-time now as a through the temp service, but doing what she loves and getting paid to do it. And there's many other examples I could give you, but what we need is longitudinal. We need research over time. Were they able to maintain 1, 3, 5 years? Can they continue to do that? We don't know that because these programs in this country are new enough. We're just getting that data, but I think it's promising. We're seeing some great. 5 of those original 18 that graduated are living in their own apartments. They need some supports. We've done a work really hard to help our students become aware of, I said, their spins, and to be able to spend time matching to get what job do you want to match a realistic match. We have students that come in, and one said they wanted to be a jet pilot. Great! Yes! Let's first learn what your spins are. And then let's learn what it's going to take to be a jet pilot. Now you lay the skills you need to be a jet pilot. Which list does it match? Till they come to the understanding, the self-awareness of, okay, I might not be able to be a jet pilot, but how close to the jet can I get? Now we got something to work with. It is not up to us to tell them what they can or can't do, but it is up to us to provide the opportunities for them to become aware of themselves so that they begin to make better decisions for themselves. And so for that reason, it's not an accident that self-awareness is encasing all of the other skills, because without it, there is no hope for change. Students must have a good sense of self. This is the blue and the green model of self-determination. You cannot read a book and be self-determined. To be a self-determined person, you must have an interaction, a hands-on interaction with something you're doing with your environment. That's why opportunities are so important. I remember I said earlier that our students with disabilities are not provided the same opportunities. And if you don't have those opportunities, it could be something of the most simplest thing to something great, a greater opportunity. But if we don't flood them with opportunities, they will not be self-determined. Because it's through those opportunities that the student, the person gaining, and you know, I'm talking about students being in here, but it could be you. This is everybody. All of us use these skills, and we're never perfect throughout our entire life. It's always an endeavor. When it came to developing a program or finishing my degrees, I am probably one of the most self-determined persons that you could ever meet. But darn it, I cannot stick to a diet worth anything. I'm missing self-regulation. I could set the goal, and I know the reason why I need to. But boy, when that cake or brownie is sitting on the counter, there is not much monitoring going on. Okay? So, when we have lots of opportunities, from those opportunities, we gain knowledge. And now we can make some decisions about that knowledge. And when we're making that decision of saying, this is something that's interesting, it becomes meaningful to me, meaningful to your student. And it isn't until it comes to that attitude of readiness or this means something to me, it's only then that we can start developing skills. We could work with them all day long to say, you need these skills, you need to have these skills, but if they don't know why it's meaningful to them, it's not going to be developed to the depth that makes lasting lifelong changes or skills. But as the skills begin to develop, and then more opportunities, more knowledge, more meaningful. And that begins to circle, begins to spin. What's happening on the outside is the green, and that's all of us. We are the environment. And our job is to provide and flood with the opportunities, to provide that feedback, to say, do you know what you're doing right now? You're problem solving. You just set a goal. You just reached a goal. It's our job to promote awareness of what they are doing until they can finally recognize, this is what I am doing. Providing access to social networks and more opportunities. And so we're kind of spinning too. But nowhere do you see the green or the blue touching. You want to know what pisses me off with my husband so fast? I'll be trying to open the pickle jar, and I'm struggling. And he reaches in and takes that jar out of my hand, opens it up, and there you go, honey. Now, he loves me. He wants the best for me. What's that?
You loosened it. That's how he got it open.
Well, he wouldn't take that. He probably wouldn't say that I loosened it and got it ready for him. But I get mad because I didn't ask for his help. He just reached in and took it. He reached into my blue. We may really love our, we do. We love our children. We love our students. And with the best of intentions, we're reaching in, thinking we're helping. But what you're actually doing is giving the subconscious messages, I don't think you can do this. And boy, you want to know what's damaging? Is that I was talking to a dad and his son that he came in just last week, and he had just heard about the program, and he came in and wanted to hear more. And when I told him this, he got real quiet. And he looked at his son and he says, do I do that? And his son said, yes, you do. And he says, do I make you feel like that? And he says, yes. I don't think you think I can do things. There were some tears shed that day. But dad loves, you love your kids. But are you giving the message, I don't think you can? So leave my pickle jar alone. Now, if I get to the point that I can say, husband, strong man of mine, would you please help me with my pickle jar? I've invited him into my blue. That's different because I was aware I'm struggling. I'm aware I'm going to need a resource to help me do this. And since he's right there, he's my resource. And I've invited him in to help me. That is completely different than grabbing it out of my hands. So if I leave you with no other thought today, if you're grabbing and you're doing for without allowing the student a chance to become aware of what they are doing, why they might need help, but there's nothing wrong with letting them struggle until they get it. I have a video. I wish, you gotta have me come back. I have videos that we'll watch, like if you were going through the training, we'll talk about a particular one problem solving, we'll talk about it, we'll look at all the steps, and then we'll watch some videos so that you could say, I see it right there. It's pretty powerful. But there's a video of a young boy trying to learn how to tie his shoes. And he's struggling, and he's struggling, and he's got him on the wrong feet, and you could just see what's going on. How many times when our kids are little that we just grab them and they're trying to learn how to tie their shoes and we don't have time. We got to go. Let me time and let's go. And we lost the opportunity to say, let's just slow it down for the moment and let it unfold. Don't take the chance to go and buy zipper shoes. When just take it, slow down the moment. Slow the learning moment down and let it unfold. You're going to be amazed at what you see. But you have to do some of Ron's meditation sometimes, maybe while you're waiting that, because it takes patience to do that. I have so much I would love to share with you. And I would love to share with some of the victorious things that we're seeing and some of the heartbreaking things that we're seeing with our students who have come to us and lacking. Technology skills. I don't understand this. But every student that has come to us in the program have not had technology skills. They may be able to do social media, might be able to play video games, things like that, but to use a computer to be able to do the things that you need to use it to write a thank you note after an employer has taken the time to interview you. Or let's just talk about, when's the last time you filled out you applied for a job and the application wasn't online? Boy, if you want anything for an IEP goal, is get them involved as much as you can in as many computer, because it's not going away. As much as I'd like it to, I can't even run this little pusher button thing. All right. Oh, man, I could talk. We should have brought our pajamas and we should have just settled in for the night. But, well, the last thing I said was, because the green is surrounding the blue, we can give the blue some leeway to move. If they get too off-center, too unsafe, they're going to run into us, and we can bounce them back. But we must give them that chance to wiggle a little bit. As we gain confidence, and as they gain confidence, self-efficacy, we can widen that green out wider and wider till they have more opportunities to make decisions and do that. But that's a process, but we've got to start it. Sorry. Thank 5 minutes over. Thank you. I have pamphlets here if you want for the program.
So those are